I'm Liz Brown Swanson, and you are watching RPV City Talk on the road. It is a gorgeous day here in Rancho Palos Verdes, and we are coming to you from Ladera Linda Community Center and Park. I'm with the great mayor of Rancho Palos Verdes, Mayor Eric Alegria. Thank you for joining us once again for your monthly update. You know, we've been going from neighborhood to neighborhood each month to talk about issues important in our city, especially in each neighborhood. And Ladera Linda has been a topic of discussion for years now regarding building a new community center here. We're going to fill you in on what's going on and everything else happening in RPV. So with that, let's find out how you're doing as mayor these days.
It's another beautiful day, Liz, in RPV, and glad we're through the reopening, recovering, getting better. Life is good.
I know. I think our community now is more than half vaccinated.
That's right.
We are seeing RPV going strong together, and it's just so nice to be out here. But we're still socially distancing and being safe in what we do. We have so much to talk about, a lot of exciting news in the city. We were just, as a city, ranked the fourth safest city in California. Tell us all about that, what that means. And I know we're up from being sixth last year, so that's amazing. No, congratulations.
Thank you. So excited about that, Liz. I know I talked about that earlier in the year, really a desire for us as a city to get in that top five. So here we are, truly a product of a lot of work and contributions in terms of the Sheriff's Department, city staff, our community coming together around public safety. And I'll highlight the fact that out of the top 10 cities in California, we are the only city in LA County that was ranked in the top 10. So just an added bonus. This statistic comes to us by way of SafeWise, which is a leading safety firm specializing in home security advice and services. And they do it based on crime statistics. So per 1,000 residents statistics, and we're at a 0.7 violent crime rate and a 7.5 property crime rate, which puts us well below the state and national averages for both of those metrics. And that's the way they measure safety. And of course, we always say any crime is too much crime.
Right.
And we continue to strive towards improvement, but we're quite pleased with our progress.
We all, I feel like, as a community, we work together with Neighborhood Watch, our Alameda Sheriff's Department, the resources that our city continues to put into protecting the public. Anything you want to add as we move on now to focus on Ladera Linda regarding public safety and this incredible, the fact that we are the fourth safest city? Anything else you want to add?
It's just one of those things. You have to remain always diligent. So the work continues, I guess, is the message
right.
I'd like to send. It's we have to stay diligent, continue to work together in order to maintain that great status that we have as one of the absolutely safest cities in the state of California.
And if you see something, say something. We always say that. You know, as we sit here at Ladera Linda, of course, the city's park rangers are based here, and they're out every day doing work, also trying to help keep our community safe. Let's focus now on what's going on here. On April 6th, the city council voted to approve the Ladera Linda Community Center park and project. This construction could, I think, start by December, right, at the end of the year. And let's face it, you've been debating this, the council, the community, for years.
Yes.
So tell us what you approved.
So yes, April 6th, we did approve. And actually back in 2019, I'll say the prior council actually approved at least the design of the project for a new Ladera Linda Community
right.
Center. And on April 6th, after the Planning Commission had a chance to look at it and apply recommendations related to conditions to manage the community center, the council essentially revisited the design question and also the conditions of approval and a conditional use permit for this property, and ultimately voted to approve and proceed with a design as well as the conditional conditions of use
right.
for the property.
And I mean, the city, the staff, the council, you guys have done so much outreach with the community. Talk about, highlight the features of what this center is going to be like. What's all about? What's it all about? 6,800 square foot around there?
That's correct. Roughly 6,800 square feet in terms of the actual facility itself. A lot of the sort of core uses that you have today are ones that we're going to restore. So we have basketball courts currently. We are going to have a court and a half, a full basketball court plus a half a basketball court. We are going to have the two paddle courts, which to my surprise continue to be very popular,
yes,
but very used here in the facility. And then I'm sure the kids out there and the families will be excited to hear that we're also going to have a new area where we're going to have jungle gym and a whole area for kids to take advantage of as well. Then certainly we're going to take advantage and have a lot of open space, grass, trails sort of traversing the property so people can take nice walks, enjoy the scenery, and just enjoy time in RPV.
The building that will be here with all these different uses is certainly a scaled down version of what initially was first presented years ago to this community, right? I think
Correct.
We've tried to listen so that it's not some massive footprint here. It's going to be done beautifully and with a lower impact. And what are you excited about when you saw the plans rolled out? I mean, you've been listening to these plans for a long time. What did you like when you saw the project?
Gosh, I'm excited to have a place. I mean, if you look at the current facility, we are in such a great location, but the condition of our facility today is not appropriate for our community. So as you highlighted, a lot of outreach, a lot of thought went into the right and appropriate size of the facility. But at the end of it all, I'm looking forward to HOA events being conducted here and meetings with the city and a place for people to in the residents in the community to come celebrate notable events and milestones and all of that. So it's gonna be a great place for our community to come together.
And is it going to be an expensive project?
15.7 million is correct.
So talk about how this is going to get funded and a little bit of the financing.
Sure. No, happy to. So 15.7 million, about 6 million of that's for the actual building. And then there's a whole lot of site work that needs to be done. So a big portion is going to go towards the site improvements throughout this whole, the whole area here. What's happened is the Finance Advisory Committee is looking at what options may be available to the city to finance the $15.7 million project. Because we've actually already initiated the design itself, we're looking at a traditional approach to simply just owning the development from soup to nuts, so to speak, from the beginning to the end. And really all options at this point are being looked at by the Finance Advisory Committee from using our capital improvement reserve fund, which we have, and which is at healthy levels, a portion of as a down payment or up to 100%. So, you know, given the options that are available to us, the Finance Advisory Committee met and discussed this on April 22nd, so last week.
Right.
And they've already taken really proactive steps to break up into two subcommittees. They're going to have one more meeting on May 6th to really dig into not only the capital costs, but also understand the operating costs for the project. And then also come back to us with the recommendations. And on May 18th, our city council will meet and look at the options available and hopefully make a decision.
Okay. Let's move talk a little bit about the history of this 11-acre site that it originally started as an elementary school in the 1960s. Just bring us through a little bit of the history and then how it came that we came to this conclusion that these buildings needed to come down. But we needed a serious makeover here.
Yes, indeed. So, yes, I'm sure many of our longstanding residents recall and perhaps even had some of their children go through the school. So this was Ladera Linda Elementary School through the 60s, 70s, all the way up until the early 1980s. So it was owned by the Palos Verdes School District all the way up until the early 80s when the city acquired the property and turned it into a community center, of course, which it's been now. And in that time, it's been utilized by the city for the last, 40 years to have a range of classes, use the multi-purpose room that's sort of behind where we're at currently. And certainly over a series of years and finally culminating 2013, the city did its infrastructure evaluations and this facility received a grade F, which is the, as you can imagine, the worst grade that you can get for infrastructure. So certainly significant safety concerns. And as we're describing, really, since 2013 till now, it's been a process of the city looking at, you know, what we want to do with this particular site.
So, as you were saying, there's been a lot of time and energy spent to figure out how we could best serve our community with what goes in here. And the concerns we're hearing from this neighborhood, which you've taken very seriously, are everything from traffic coming into Forestall. This is off a major arterial and it's a one-way street in, or there's dead ends. You've got traffic issues, they've concerned about security and crime, and just the whole impact that having the uses here Obviously, there's soccer fields up above in the school district. Can you just talk about how the city is going to address neighborhood concerns so that this all works?
Yeah, great question, Liz. And yes, I do want to acknowledge that there's been certainly a commentary and feedback from our residents letting us know about their concerns throughout this process. And certainly a significant effort to hear, address those concerns, but the work continues. But I'll most significantly highlight the security and safety features. So that is certainly one of the bigger concerns. You know, having a community center adjacent to a neighborhood, this is a unique area where this is located. We want to make sure that we have all the most up-to-date security features for the new facility, such as surveillance cameras, drop-down gates, clear points of entries and exits, glass break sensors, you know, great lighting. And then this is one of the common things we're hearing, just staff. They want to see the neighborhoods in the area. Certainly have made clear to us, and understandably so, that they want to make sure that during times of opening that there is presence by way of staff and our rangers and just general presence to make sure that it's nice, safe, and secure for people to come and enjoy. So we're working through those concerns.
And when you mentioned glass sensors, I mean, the architectural design, there is a lot of glass involved in this project. And I think obviously to take advantage of this incredible view,
yes,
right? In terms of the actual, the way it all lays out. Again, emphasizing that it's a 6,700 square foot building, which reduces from what's here is what, 18,000 square
Correct,
feet.
Over 18,000
buildings around us
currently. So it is a third of what, in terms of the actual building size, a third of what it is currently.
And the different uses that are going to be here for the community to enjoy, how do you see this serving the community going forward in a better way than it's doing now?
Well, I suspect, you know, once we have a beautiful facility, our residents are really going to want to come utilize it. As I highlighted earlier, the multi-purpose room is going to be a major function that allow people to have, you know, moderately sized gatherings. Certainly HOA meetings is a common occurrence in our community,
right,
which we envision, you know, happening. And then we're going to have two classrooms as well, which we hope will be utilized by our Parks and Rec programming as it has, traditionally as well.
As I sit here, I'm right across from what's the Discovery Room, a very popular room here with all kinds of artifacts and history from our community. What's going to happen there? I know we're not having a museum in this new center. They're not calling it that, but there will be the Discovery display. Well, can you highlight that?
Correct. Yes. So as part of the process of working with the community, doing outreach, there was a lot of discussion on what do we do with the Discovery Room and all these great artifacts that we have here. And ultimately, what is part of the design that was approved by council is the idea that we're going to have a meeting room that will have encasings that allow people to, is accents to the room, essentially, so people can come in. Particularly, you know, our docents, for instance, who are going to be talking to kids who come through about what's in our preserve and our history here on the peninsula. That will be an opportunity to kind of show off those casings around the room and talk a little bit about that. Some will be stored and then others will, we may look for locations at PVIC and other places to maybe highlight as well. But the idea is we want to continue the spirit of having at least some of those artifacts available for viewing and then others will be stored.
A lot of great memories have been made here over 40 years and many more to come, including one of my favorites, and I think yours is, the annual egg extravaganza in the spring. There's a wonderful egg hunt for the community. But because of COVID last year it was canceled, but this year they were able to pull off, they called it the Golden Egg Hunt, and it was done like for individual families, but your kids were up here hopping around, and there was, I think, hundreds of kids that participated all week at the end of March, actually. We have footage of that, including your kids. What are some of your memories you might want to share?
I have wonderful memories related to Easter, related to this location. One of my favorite duties, being on the city council, frankly, has been to send off, not last year, of course, but the two prior years when we were prior to COVID. I had the opportunity to do the countdown, as you may recall, for I think 100 plus children who are here to do the egg hunt. Mm-hmm. And, just being able to say ready, set, go to all those kids and see them and their faces light up and have them jog down the, down the way into the grass to get the eggs was just the highlight of my time on council.
They're going to have a beautiful new lawn to roll those eggs on.
That's right.
Before you know it. And I know December, as we started talking about what's going on here, possibly groundbreaking and things starting to happen, right?
Yes.
So what is like, when do you think that you'll have a ribbon cutting here one day?
Oh, that's a good question. Hard to predict. You know, I think in a best case scenario, it could be as soon as, I think end of 2022, perhaps. You know, we are scheduled somewhat optimistically to break ground by the tail end of this year.
Mm-hmm.
But I should emphasize that there's just a lot of things that are dependent on that timeline. But that's the hope, is that in the near future, we'll have a new beautiful site here for the community to enjoy.
Right. And, you know, obviously the financial piece is huge. This is like the biggest infrastructure project at this point happening. We have lots of others, the Big Five, that we'll talk about in other shows, whether it's Portuguese Bend, the Civic Center. The city's got a lot of big ticket items, and under these difficult, more challenging economic mm-hmm. times, right? That's what makes your job challenging. And I have to note that you have to, if you turn on the April 6th City Council meeting, you can click on that when you're reviewing what was going on here. It's a great PowerPoint if you want to understand this project more. Really, the architect presents really well, and you get understanding. And you do hear from the residents as well
mm-hmm.
that are concerned how it's going to be impact. But the big picture of the entire city as a community, you've got a lot of support from the surrounding HOAs as well. So I'm excited. I live in Seaview, so I mean, I'm looking forward to seeing what will be up here, and I think it's gonna be great.
I do too, so excited.
And, so we'll bring our rackets one day soon and
I'll give that paddle ball a chance.
Anything you wanna add as we kind of go on to some other topics? One thing I wanted to mention when we talk about issues of concern would be that intersection to get in here. I heard some talk about possibly maybe a pilot roundabout that might be
take
a look at that to see if that might be a way to solve traffic issues coming into this neighborhood across from Trump National on PV Drive South. Can you talk about that?
Yes, happy to touch on that. Thank you for asking that, Liz. So certainly as part of this broader evaluation of what we can do in this area to improve safety and security and traffic, one of the concerns that's been voiced to us from the community is the intersection at Forestal and PV Drive South. It is a challenging intersection. So we're looking at different ways perhaps to improve that intersection. And so as part of our capital improvement workshop 2 weeks ago, the council agreed that we wanted to include at least dollars for a pilot to put in a traffic circle into that intersection to see if that would be a successful solution to that intersection.
Right. Keep us posted on that. We will circle back on the roundabout in a
well
future
said.
City Talk show. All right. So I think we're going to move off Ladera Linda and what's happening here and talk about other exciting news in the city. A shuttle service was launched. The Palos Verdes Nature Preserve Shuttle Service pilot program. It leaves from City Hall as a way to help relieve pressure of people parking at Del Cerro Park, free parking now to come see the preserve at different locations. I'm gonna let you talk about how that's going.
Happy to touch on it. It's still early in the process. We just implemented it a couple of weeks ago as part of our holistic approach to the preserve and parking around the preserve. So we have preserve ambassadors who are actually on foot
mm-hmm.
Within the Del Cerro community, talking to people as they arrive and letting them know about this alternative option of going to City Hall, Alta Vicente, parking and then jumping on this shuttle to be taken to one of three location possibilities
mm-hmm.
Throughout PV Drive South, all in public access points for the preserve away from our neighborhoods, and that's really the hope and intent. And so far, so good. We had 185 trips that have been counted thus far over just two weekends, and a fair amount of that are preserve ambassadors talking to those people coming to the community saying, hey, we want to enjoy a day at the preserve. We had no idea that there was an option outside of this area, Del Cerro, and they're taking advantage of it so far. So we're going to do, as you recall, a 90-day pilot and then reassess and reevaluate.
Right. And there's the PV transit shuttles. And also because we're still in the pandemic, there are 12 riders allowed at one time because they have 24 seaters. But you can bring your dogs on board, which has been nice. I did ride the first weekend and saw the riders that were bringing dogs, and they liked having that ability. And I did talk to some of the people that took advantage of it and said that now that they know that they can take this and not have to deal with parking at Del Cerro, especially as we're waiting to see the parking app get implemented there as another way to control parking into that heavier used area. But the good news is there's so many beautiful spots, whether you get dropped off at PVIC, ABCO, or Gateway, that this shuttle is servicing. So it'll be exciting to see what the result will be.
I'm excited to see. I understand our residents are actually using it quite a bit as well,
right,
which is also part of the hope and intent. And
it's on the weekends.
Functioning, yeah, for Friday through Sunday, 8 till 5:30, every 30 minutes. So
okay.
those residents who want to go check it out, go for a ride.
One of the spots that it stops is the Point Vicente Interpretive mm-hmm. Center, which we are so excited is officially reopened. And so to share what the news and how our city was able to, after a year being shut down, reopen that treasure with new exhibits to boot.
That's right. Go to our website where you can get a great virtual tour if you're not able to actually visit in person. But as you noted, it is open now. So we're hoping that people will come out and take a look at both the whale and the bird exhibits as well.
Yeah.
You can
go to whaleofaday.com as well to virtually tour. And if you do want to go down to PVIC, you do make a reservation. So you go on the city website and you can reserve party of six. I actually had visitors. So we went and we saw the brand new panel. It's technically, I think, considered four new exhibits that they have that celebrates local habitat, and it's really, really well done. So, and it was busy. A lot of people out looking for whales, and I saw two fluking whales. I hadn't seen them all season.
That's great.
So what a place to be and stop and check it all out.
I want to highlight something important related to Point Vicente Interpretive Center, which is in the last council meeting, the Mayor Pro Tem Bradley and the rest of the council requested to put on a future agenda the renaming of the Point Vicente Interpretive Center to the Ken Dida Interpretive Center at Point Vicente in honor of Councilman Dida, who is a current council member, but also, as many in our community know very well, was one of our city founders and has been just instrumental to our city. And he's been wonderful to work with, given his passion for our community. It's well deserved.
He is a legend. He was a city founder, as you said, 50 years of service to our community on the council, still 50 years later. I love the fact that he is our oldest councilman serving with our youngest mayor ever in the city. So you guys are a dream team together, dynamic duo, and well deserved. And you had to vote on that because technically, the way the city's policies are, you don't name anything until someone's gone, but why not celebrate while he's still
that's
here
correct.
Working on behalf of the city if that can be done?
That's absolutely right. And so we have our policies, and in fact, that's how it came about in that council meeting, as we were reviewing all of our policies and updating them. And one of the policies, Policy 37, speaks to kind of how renaming of facilities occurs. And we as a council essentially agreed we should agendize and have a good discussion about this because this is an opportunity that's a unique situation to honor somebody that certainly deserves to be honored.
And he has been so dedicated to everything in our city, but especially Point Vicente Interpretive Center, as someone that was, you know, president in charge of the PV Historical Society and wanting to preserve the history of our hill. What a place. It's the perfect building to rename on his behalf. Nice. And that will be a whale of an event.
That will be a whale of an event.
Well deserved. No.
And for anyone who's interested in his contribution to the city, if you just look at his biography on the city website, you will be blown away by the level of time and the different roles that he's played in supporting our city. So it's an honor that's well deserved. And I look forward to that discussion at a future council meeting.
Excellent. What's being discussed a lot right now is budget season. And the city council has been holding public workshops to go over the 21-22 budget.
Yes.
For the fiscal year, and also the city's capital improvement plan. So just kind of highlight what residents would want to know right now about sort of the future budget and future CIP projects or capital improvement program projects.
Sure. I would suspect our residents want to know that staff came with an initial draft for our budget, and there's a process. So in May and then June, ultimately, we'll have our final review of the budget. But what's been presented is a balanced budget for our community that maintains all of our core services for the community.
Mm-hmm.
And to be able to say that in normal years is a good thing. And in a year like this post-pandemic, where in which many municipalities are struggling, is just, I think, really speaks to a lot of thoughtful leaders in our community over many, many years who've been mindful of budget and spending. And so it's exciting to see that that's the approach we're taking. As I think we've previously highlighted, there's been a bit of an impact to the transient occupancy tax, which goes directly into our capital improvement fund. So the most notable impact as a result of the pandemic is really just that we've had to kind of look back at our infrastructure projects and prioritize them based on a little bit more of a limited capital improvement fund for this year. Mm-hmm. But Terranea and our transient occupancy tax have an operational sort of scaling up plan over the next several months. And we're optimistic, given the signs that we're seeing through the reopening, that they're going to recover and we're going to have an opportunity to do continue to do all the infrastructure work that we want to do in our city. And
right. I know Terranea, everyone took such a hit. So to see that the TOT rebound will be nice to have that money coming, as well as the one-time estimated $7.8 million from federal funds. What's up with that?
That's the American Rescue Plan. Yep. From President Biden. And we're still getting information on some of the details around that. But what we do know at this point is that it's $7.8 million, as you said. It would be given to the city as a pass-through through the state, mm-hmm. and then handed off to the city in two segments, so $3.9 million at a time. And the city council has to decide what we would do with those funds. So that'll be part of our future budget discussions.
And that money goes to cities with populations of 50,000 or less, so that's how we qualify?
Correct.
All right.
Yes.
Well, that would be nice. You are busy as mayor. Thank you for all you're doing. Anything you want to highlight, mayoral activities to share that you want the residents to know about?
Well, you know, the life of a mayor is just kind of constant day to day. There's always activities. So there's the council meetings, of course, and all the work that goes into preparing for those. But that's probably what people generally see. But I will say, you know, of course, there's workshops. We highlighted both the budget and the capital workshop. There's lunches and breakfasts with my colleagues across the peninsula with other city council leaders from the South Bay. And one of my favorites is the breakfasts that we get to have internally within our city with our commission and committee leaders, chairs, mm-hmm. and vice chairs. And we had, you know, certainly that as well. But then there's always the standard sort of HOA meetings, issues with that residents are bringing and raising concerns. So it's constant, but it's fun, and it's certainly a labor of love.
And spring is in the air. It is beautiful, and it's just, I feel like the city's kind of coming to. Things are reopening.
Yes.
And anything you want to do as we wrap it up here, any additional mayor's announcements to share?
You led that perfectly, I think, Liz. So I do want to share that we are planning, you know, public health orders pending, of course, but we believe we're on track to begin to take those next steps in opening our city. And so I am happy to announce that we are planning to have our traditional 4th of July event on the 4th of July as we have in prior years. So details will be forthcoming related to that.
That's great.
And then we're also on par for other summer activities such as concerts in the park, mm-hmm. July 31st and August 28th. When we had our 45th anniversary of the city a few years ago, we had a nice concert in the park, and that we sort of noticed that there's a desire to bring our residents together and enjoy the community. And so look out for those dates as well. But I think the bottom line is we're starting to open up, and
yes,
there's going to be some opportunities in the second half of the year for us to come together.
Next month, I will see you again. And for your mayor's update, thank you again for all you do. That'll do it for this edition of RPV City Talk. I'm Liz Brown Swanson with Mayor Eric Alegria. Have a great day out there. Be safe.